My mother thought I had the best job in the world when I was doing the historic research. But before we get started on the history of White Rock Lake, I like to tell a little story about Dallas Water Utilities. White Rock Lake began as a water source. But prior to that, there was a city alderman, and he thought all of Dallas's water should come from artesian wells and not from groundwater. So he dropped a well in what's now Reverchon Park, off of Maple and Oaklawn. Problem was, it wasn't quite enough quantity, and it had a high mineral content. It was good for medicinal purposes. It was a laxative. And I had a lot of people say, oh, my dad swore by that water. He'd take his jugs and fill up his jugs, and he swore by that water. So that's my favorite story about Dallas Water Utilities. In 1909, the city decided it was time to build a new water source. So they decided to acquire land on White Rock Creek. They acquired just a little over 2,200 acres and paid $176,000 for that. And how many square feet do you think you could buy in Lakewood, near the lake today, for 170? Just a few square feet, not a whole lot. But this is Church and Luther Goforth working their cattle. If you're familiar, this area would be just north of Northwest Highway. White Rock Creek is back in the trees. Church Goforth, there's a street in Dallas, not too far from the lake. Lake Highlands High School sits on Church Road. It's named for Church Goforth. It was named by his brother. It doesn't have anything to do with the fact that there's about four or five churches on that street. It's named for Church Goforth. And this is what the lake looked like. That was White Rock Creek. That area is now underneath. It was mostly farm and ranch land. And they left all the crops after they purchased the land, they left the crops in the field, and the city harvested the crops and sold them. But they took down all the trees, and they thought it was really interesting because they didn't sell the wood. That winter, the city gave away, through the city welfare department, the wood for cooking and heating fuel. And you want to know why it's called White Rock? This is using steam-powered jackhammers to jackhammer down through that white rock to create the intake wells. And so up on the land, it almost looks like oil derricks that created the steam to operate those jackhammers. And we always knew there was a line of the Katy Trail, you see where my mind goes to, the Katy Railroad. There was a spur that came into White Rock Lake that brought coal into the pump house. It wasn't until we found this 1909 picture that we realized it was put in before the lake was complete. It was used to haul supplies into the work site and debris out of the work site. And look right here. Can you see what that trademark is? On the St. Louis Rocky Mountain Pacific Railway car there, it's a swastika. That was a very common trademark in the United States prior to World War II. World War II changed the connotation of that trademark. And there is the brand new completed pump house in 1911. They finished. It was state of the art. It pumped the water directly from the lake to your house. It was neither filtered nor was it chlorinated. It literally went from the lake to your house. But what made this so state of the art is this train trestle. And if you were to go out there today, you could still see those concrete stanchions. They're covered in ivy now. But that was the trestle. They could unhook the car, push it out, drop the coal underneath, and there's double doors right behind it, and they could take the coal directly into the pump house. And there's the dam, just completed in 1911, in the summer of 1911, but the lake did not fill until April of 1914, because we were in a drought. Very good. And that April afternoon, the spillway, it overflowed the spillway by 42 inches. And so those of you who've gone and watched the floods at the spillway, White Rock Lake goes from drought to flash flood in a matter of hours. It doesn't take real long. This is not a 1914 picture. This is much later. But what you see is the walkway that used to go across the spillway. Used to be able to walk across the spillway. But by 1960, in the 1960s, the flood debris finally completely took out the supports for that, and it went away. When they did some restoration out there a few years ago, they tried to figure out a way to redo that, but they can't. If you've ever watched the floods, you see whole tree bodies going over this spillway. And somebody's already asked me about the Lady of the Lake. This is my one slide to the Lady of the Lake. She's purportedly buried here at the Cox Cemetery. And what's interesting, if you've not ever been by here, it's really fascinating, the names on these headstones. It's just off of West Lothar on a street called Dow Green. It's just this little bitty two-lane road, asphalt-crowned road. And a friend of mine from church was telling me how he'd moved, and they lived on Dahlgren. I said, Dahlgren? Where's that? And I said, oh, you mean Dow Green? He goes, oh, no. There's a town in one of the Carolinas. It's spelled the same way, but it's pronounced Dahlgren. I said, yeah, but you live on what's left of the Dallas to Greenville Highway. So it's just a simple Dow Green, nothing fancy like Dahlgren. But that little street there on the northeast part of the lake, Dow Green, is actually the old Dallas to Greenville Highway prior to the construction of the lake. This cemetery predates the lake by about 30 years. In 1911, the Dallas Park Board hired George Kessler to come to Dallas to do a master plan for the city. If you've ever been to Kansas City, the City of Boulevards, that's a Kessler plan. And part of the Kessler plan is Turtle Creek, this creek. He believed in creating these boulevards. This is Dallas. Right there, that green spot is Fair Park. Each one of these rings is 5 miles. At this point, in 1911, White Rock Lake was still 10 miles outside of Dallas. It was not in the city of Dallas. It was 10 miles outside of Dallas. This little bitty green spot right here, it says Forest Park, that's now the Dallas Zoo. But he wanted all of these green belts, these boulevards, to go through. But one of the things in it that he said, White Rock Lake, now remember the lake didn't fill till 1914, but in 1911, George Kessler said, White Rock Lake needs to become a park. And if it does, it will be one of the great parks of this country. Well, more than 100 years later, it is one of the great parks of this country. One of the things, when I first got to City Hall, as he said, I was with the city for over 30 years. I spent most of it out in the field. When I first went to City Hall, nobody really knew what to do with me. And so I spent a lot of time looking in closets. That's how I ended up doing the historic research, because of all the fun things that I found. One of them was a 1921-23 Park Board report. And in that report, it listed Dallas's suburban park, because it was not in the city limits yet. So it was a suburban park in 1923. If Northwest Highway had existed, it would be right here. Today, Mockingbird crosses about right here. Today, the lake is at about 50% the capacity that it was when it was first built. They had to bring in over 6 feet of fill to fill in part of the north end of the lake to build the original lanes of Northwest Highway. So the lake originally went north of Northwest Highway. This would be a picture if you were standing on Northwest Highway looking south. Today, this is what we call Boy Scout Hill, and that's where the Mockingbird Bridge is. Look how much water is north of Mockingbird at this point. 1923, Dallas is moving uptown. We now have filtration system. So shortly after they started pumping water, they did chlorinate. And by 23, they added these filtration tanks. Kind of works like the old swimming pool filters where it would go down through all that rock and coal. There was also a jail at White Rock Lake. It was known as the Pea Patch. And you could, if you had fines you couldn't pay off, you could go work at the Pea Patch. And you actually would tend to crops and also to some animals. They grew pheasants for hunting, and they worked they raised pheasants. My mind just, I lost it. Okay, so this is West Lothar right here. This is the filtration building. This is White Rock Lake. And look at all those buildings along the lake. Those are private boathouses. Citizens paid $10 a year to the city for the right to have their private boathouse on the lake. Right here is where the jail sat. Today, there is a power plant. Encore has a large power plant. And this is where the high lines go through here. And here's just another view. You see there's the pump house, the filter building, and there is the jail. And if you look, you can see the rows. This is where they grew their crops. This is White Rock Road and Winstead. And you know this is pre-1930 because the fish hatchery has not been built yet. But look how open, there weren't any trees. It was just prairie out there. There were also, I told you about the private boathouses, there were also private clubhouses all around the lake, different companies. The largest of those was the Texas and Pacific Railroad Employees Clubhouse, T&P Clubhouse. It sits on what we now call T&P Hill. For years, there was a sign out there that said TP Hill, and those of you who were telling me they went to Woodrow probably called it TP Hill. But it was actually T&P Hill. I was doing this presentation for the Rockwall Retired Teachers, and a gentleman was in the audience that I knew as chief of the park police in Dallas before he retired. And he said, Sally, did you know that I worked at White Rock? I said, no, not a clue. He said, yeah. Well, my boss told me to put a sign at TP Hill, and that's what I did. And that's how the sign got out there that said T-E-E-P-E-E rather than T&P Hill. The bottom one is Dreyfus Club. And many of you who've been down there may remember the Dreyfus Club. It burned probably 10 to 15 years ago, but it remained very active. And the reason this one remained at the lake was because they sold it to the city for the cost they would have gotten if they'd recycled the lumber. By 1942, all of the private clubhouses had to go away. As the city limits got closer and closer, the citizens were saying, those private clubhouses are preventing me from having equal access to the lake. By 1952, all the private boathouses had to go away for the same reason. And this is Earl Hart. He was the second superintendent out at White Rock Lake. He worked there from 1929 till his sudden death in, I want to say, about 1940. He's out there in his Chris Craft boat, and you see those beautiful boathouses that were out at the lake. This is Lakewood Boulevard going up the hill. The first superintendent out at White Rock Lake was a gentleman, I just lost his name, Junius Peak. He was a retired Lone Ranger. You had to be a certified police officer to be the superintendent at White Rock Lake because you were the law. And I did some more research about Junius Peak. It's kind of interesting. Somebody was talking to me about Old East Dallas, a Peak family. He had brothers, Harwood, Haskell, and Carroll. So you can thank the Peak family for a lot of the names in Old East Dallas for those streets. He also had one sister, Juliet Peak Fowler, as in Juliet Fowler Holmes. That was Junius Peak's sister. But anyway, Earl Hart was second superintendent out at White Rock Lake. 1929, Dallas Water Utilities no longer needed White Rock Lake as a water source. They had just opened up Lake Dallas, which is now part of Lake Louisville. And they no longer needed White Rock Lake as a water source. So City Council in December of 1929 transferred the operation of the land around the lake to the Park and Recreation Department. To this day, Dallas Water Utilities is still responsible for the lake, the dam, the spillway, and the Park Department manages the land around the lake. But the first thing we built was this bathhouse. And they brought in a concrete apron and they poured sand and they called it a swimming pool. And if you didn't have a bathing suit, not to worry, you could rent one here. And one of my husband's customers said he remembers standing and waiting in line for a bathing suit to come back in so that he could rent it. Yes, and here is a view. As I said, we called it a swimming pool. We actually went out in boats and chlorinated the lake. And that got a little labor intensive. So there's a pipe that goes from the bathhouse down into the lake to chlorinate the lake. And swimming was prohibited. In early 1953, the polio epidemic, the pool closed early that season. Did not open the next season because of the drought. Dallas Water Utilities had to reactivate the pumps. And they said no more swimming with them using the water for drinking water again. But what's interesting is it never reopened. And I like to think that we figured out it maybe wasn't a good idea to chlorinate the lake. I don't know, but yes, we did chlorinate the lake. And I've heard a lot of people say, anybody here swim? There were some people who grew up in this. Anybody swim in this lake? If you could swim out to that diving platform, which is still out in the lake, you had really made it if you could make it out to that diving platform. This was the place to swim. That same year, they also built the boathouse. And both of these are in an Art Deco style. The first picnic pavilion built at the lake. It's near Buckner and Lake Highlands, and it's called Stone Tables. If you look at the tables around this pavilion, and they were designed by Mrs. Sampson Smith, the first female park board member in 1930. Rosemary Rumbly wrote a book about the park board. It took her over 6 months to find out what Mrs. Sampson Smith's first name was. Her obituary even listed her as Mrs. Sampson Smith. It took Rosemary quite a while to figure that out. But I always thought it was really interesting that they built this first picnic pavilion where you can't see the lake. The lake is not visible from this location. But I think when they built it, it very possibly you could see the lake. And there it is, the fish hatchery. This is built directly behind the dam, and it operated from 1930 until the mid-60s. And in the mid-30s, they actually transferred. There was a state fish hatchery at Fair Park, and they moved that operation to here. So this operated for a few years as a fish hatchery, a state fish hatchery. If you go back in there now, the tanks were never dismantled. And it is a wildlife viewing area. And it's just, the wildlife back in there is just wonderful. This is the first sailboats at White Rock Lake. It's a Tomcat. And the reason they had to develop sailing clubs at White Rock, these big heavy boats, and people didn't have trailers to trailer them around, so they had to have a place to put them in the water and moor them. And so that's where the boat clubs came in. And the first one, the Dallas Sailing Club, right now the sailing clubs are located on the east side of the lake. This was, the first one was actually on the northwest side of the lake. 1935, FDR's Back to Work program, the CCC, the Civilian Conservation Corps, came to White Rock. The camps were managed by the Army, but all the plans were done by the National Park Service. So this is the National Park Service master plan for White Rock Lake. And I was telling you about stone tables. It sits right here. Look how wide open that bay was. Now it's a creek going through there. I think with that bay being that wide open, you could see the water when that was built. And this is the north end of the lake. There's the dam and spillway. And this is the camp. It was at Winfrey Point. That's Garland Road at the top of the hill. And I met a gentleman who signed up in 1939. He was 16 and in the sixth grade. And when he got there, they asked him if he could drive a truck. He said, sure enough. Well, no, he didn't have a clue what he was doing. And he ended up almost in the lake. It's on a hill. And it was almost in the lake before he figured out what the brakes were. He did end up being a truck driver. And they did work at Bachman Lake, which is at the other end of Northwest Highway. And he said there were five homes between White Rock Lake and Bachman Lake. And if he passed 10 cars on the highway, it was a really busy day on that road. Also, the Army would put governors on their trucks to prevent them from going over a certain speed limit. So these young guys, you know, young guys on their own for the first time, they could get into a little trouble. You put 200 young men together, they can get into some trouble. But they would take the trucks up to the top of Flagpole Hill, release the clutch, blow up the governor so they could drive as fast as they wanted. When war broke out, if you were in the CCC, you were automatically inducted into one of the branches of the service. He ended up going into the Army. And he'd earned his GED while he was there. And he said he was really nervous. They sent him to a diesel mechanics class. And he was there with guys who had real high school diplomas. Some of them even went to college. He did so well. He ended up going to USC and earning a degree in engineering. So he went from 16 and in the sixth grade to a degree in engineering from USC. And he said that was all possible because of the CCC. So this is the camp, and you see the barracks. These are the hutments. If you did not have a high school diploma, you were required to go to class at night and earn your GED. And these young men got paid $30 a month. 22 of it got sent home to support the family, and they got to keep 8. And this is kind of an overview. If you look at Google Earth on your computer, that's what the kind of green back behind. But I took a map done by the Park Service, geo-referenced it to find out exactly where that camp was. So this is the building Winfrey Point. These are the ball diamonds back in the back side of Winfrey Point. That's exactly where the camp was. And we did a project at Winfrey Point, and after it was all said and done, the fire marshal said, you got to move your fire hydrant, it's too far. The fire hydrant was at the dugout of the ball fields. So the architect is out back asking me, he goes, why would they put a fire hydrant down at the softball fields? And I said, if you had 200 young men living in wooden buildings, you'd want a fire hydrant close by. He said, don't tell the fire marshal it's that old. We do have a new fire hydrant, but that fire hydrant is still there at the dugout. So if you were to ever go by, there's a state historical marker, but you can also see that fire hydrant. That is what remains of the old CCC camp. This first group of boys, 1935, wearing the hand-me-down World War I uniforms. I've gone to several reunions where they find the oldest and the youngest. And one time the youngest went up to get his little award, and somebody yelled out, "You must have lied about your age." He yelled back at him, "No, my mama did." Would a mama lie about their son's age to get him in the CCC? Oh yeah, that was $22 they got to feed the rest of the family. So yeah, mama would lie about their son's age. This is from that first yearbook. This is a building, they actually built at Fair Park for the centennial. It was a CCC exhibition building. But this is the construction. This is the road that goes up and around Flagpole Hill, Durand Circle. That is the pavilion at the top of Flagpole Hill under construction in 1935. Oh, I just love this is the recreation room that was out at the camp. And this actually got moved to one of our parks and operated as a community recreation center until 1990. It was out at Exall Park. But I love the wrought iron work and the chairs. And here, my boss and I were laughing at this picture. You see these big, heavy shirts? We're going, it looks like it's spring or summer. All the trees have leaves on them, and they're wearing this big, heavy shirt. They're building those bollards, those concrete bollards that keep you from driving off the road. But back here in the corner, there's a bunch of guys back there that have no shirts on, and they're all laughing. But I just love the Cheshire grin on this one. Don't you know he could get into some trouble? We also, the city, joint project, city and the CCC, they got a dredge. And the first week they had the dredge on the water there in Dixon Bay, they sunk it. And the city staff blamed the CCC boys, said they were all drunk. They brought in a diver from Galveston who came in and raised it and said, nah, it was the city staff who didn't know what they were doing. But it operated off and on from 1935 to 1942. It reclaimed 10 acres of lake there in Dixon Bay and another 25 acres north at the north end of the lake. This would be north of Mockingbird today. And this little park, this hill, is a park in Dallas. It used to be part of White Rock Lake, but it's known as Norbuck Park. The city was very creative in naming this park. It sits at the intersection of Northwest Highway and Buckner. Norbuck is where that park gets its name. And that's where our mule barns used to be, is in that park. And this is 1936. A lot of you may have seen the Texas Centennial, the lights, you see them over Fair Park, over the Esplanade. This is the lights over White Rock Lake. Those are the Texas Centennial lights over White Rock Lake in 1936. And this is Daffy Duck. I like to say Daffy Duck was hatched at White Rock Lake. Tex Avery, who is a creator of a lot of the Looney Tunes, graduated from North Dallas High School in 1926. He went on, created the Looney Tunes. First film Daffy appeared in was Porky's Duck Hunt in 1937. And Tex said his inspiration for Daffy Duck was duck hunting at White Rock Lake. So I like to claim him as ours. This is a gentleman down here. His name is William Duran. Some of the family members say it's Doran, but I've always heard it pronounced Duran. There was a large Chevrolet dealership in Dallas, Duran Chevrolet. That was his descendant. He was a city commissioner. His job was to go around and work with all the property owners, negotiate with them to buy all the land that became White Rock Lake. There's this little point. This is Northwest Highway. This is Buckner. And there's this little peninsula that comes out here, and it's known as Durand's Point. The water used to come up there. Durand's Point is still there. It's just surrounded by trees. You can see it because of the trees. What I find interesting about this plan that was done by the Park Service in 19, I forgot the year on this, it's about 38, they did this study, and the main branch of White Rock Creek was this westerly branch. The middle branch was the original branch, and at this time, the eastwardly branch was only filled during times of flood. I find it fascinating because today, this is the main branch of White Rock Creek. And I know it's through floods and droughts that it changes, but I just find it fascinating that it changed. And this is Johnny Williams Jr. and his concession. He did taxi rides in his Chris Craft boats. And he took a lot of pictures. Dallas Times Herald, if they were having a slow news day, they'd ask him to come take pictures. This is Peggy Chandler in 1940. She was a model, but she also was a semi-pro golfer. She won the state tournament. She's the one the next year got beat by Babe Dietrichson, and she's the one that turned Babe in, saying she wasn't truly an amateur, and that whole debacle with Babe. She's the one who did that. 1943, I think, I don't know when this was, I've lost it. But L.B. Houston was the director of the Dallas Park and Recreation Department from 1939. He took over during a crisis time, and he was just going to be there for about 6 months to get the department going in the right direction. And he retired in 1973. But his wife was taking biology at SMU and drew this on the flora and fauna at White Rock Lake. Who eats what and whom at the lake? One of the other treasures I found, remember CCC went away when we entered the war, and they had just started construction on Winfrey Point in 1941. And so the city had to finish it. And I found a folder with these pictures still stapled on paper, and there was a letter in front from L.B. Houston to the regional director of the National Park Service in 1943, saying, "I understand why you can't come to Dallas, the war, but I want to share with you some things that the CCC built." So we're going to take a little tour around the lake. This is 1943, the main entrance at East Lothar, and there it is today. And that's a side view of that bridge, and as it is today. Winfrey Point, when it was first built, look how little that tree is. There it is today. Tree's a little bit bigger. When we first found these pictures, we just started a renovation project on Winfrey Point. No one had ever seen there had been shutters on the windows. My boss is walking around the office going, "Change order, change order." They put them back based on what we found. And this is a little further north. This is Big Thicket. I'm sorry, that's Sunset Inn. And there it is today. Those trees look a little different, don't they? And there's a side view. And the sign up front says Sunset Inn, snacks, drinks, and sandwiches. It was built, it's a concession building. And there's another view. And what's really interesting, if you stop and look at this building, one of the things the CCC would do is they would not plane the edge of the wood. They would leave that natural tree line. And so you see a lot of that tree line still there. So that's original on those end pieces. The caretaker's house, it was a park caretaker's house. We now actually use this for an office. We have some really wonderful offices. This is over by Stone Tables. This is the restroom building. And the wrought iron work in these windows is just beautiful. The building between the years and the termites, it's seen better days. But over there is this stone bridge to nowhere. If you ever go out there, you just see this stone bridge. We found the plans. It was a lily pond. And now that you know that, and you can see the water still coming, there's a spring under this cottonwood that goes underneath East Lothar, and water still flows into here. That's one of the things we'd love to be able to restore. This is a little further north. This is Big Thicket. Look at those four trees out front. That was after a recent restoration project. It was so bad between the prevailing winds and the termites, you could see through underneath those windows, and it's been completely rebuilt. Somebody sent me this in the snow. I just thought it was pretty. This is the building that sits at the foot of Flagpole Hill. This is the reason they moved when they elevated Northwest Highway into a bridge. They moved it to the south so that bridge would not be in the roof line of this historic building. And there it is. And the design that's done by the National Park Service is known as NPS Rustic, National Park Service Rustic. All of the buildings are supposed to look like they're naturally erupting out of the ground. I never really knew that before, but I always thought these buttresses here made interesting pieces, but it's kind of modified, but it's to help make that building look like it's coming up out of the ground. Oops, wrong button. Front doors, those are the original front doors. I officed here for a while, and people would get in this door and they could not get out. There's not a doorknob. You have to lift a hook to open the door. But isn't that wrought iron work beautiful? That's original. And a gentleman by the name of Henry Potter did all the wrought iron work out here. So those sconces, the where you clean your boots, and that's all original. That's a pavilion out at the top of Flagpole Hill. What do you see back behind it? Lake. What do you see behind it now? Trees, where that whole north end of the lake is silted in. This is the plan for the overlook at White Rock, at Flagpole Hill. There it is today. And we also found the plans for the picnic tables that were built out at White Rock Lake. It cost $540 to build 30 cypress tables. We have wonderful carpenters in our department. We gave them this plan. They ordered sinker cypress. It cost $3,000 to get enough cypress to build one table. What happens when you sit on one side of a wooden picnic table? It flips. Let me tell you, you can put four people on one side of this table. It does not go anywhere. It's a wonderfully built table. We could not afford to mass produce it, so we have worked with a manufacturer who has modified the design, and we have begun repopulating White Rock Lake with the White Rock Lake CCC table. Now, if you go to some Texas Parks and Wildlife State Parks, you may find this table. They borrowed our plan. They have other plans, but they like this one. There was also a restaurant over at Sunset Inn, and this is the menu. This is Mrs. Hart. After her husband died, she was given the contract for the restaurant. It's at 830 Lothar Drive on the east side of White Rock Lake, 1.7 miles from Garland Road. If you get lost, go fishing and have a fish fry. The menu, breakfast, don't get up too early because we don't either. And the breakfast at 65 cents, this is good on payday. The breakfast, 55 cents, this is okay. It's probably the middle of the week. For 35 cents, say you're not hungry, but it's probably the day before payday. And down at the bottom, it says eggs from our poultry farm, milk, cream, and butter from our dairy. We can dream, can't we? The dinners were $1.50. They were worth half the price. And at the bottom, it says equipment from the finance company, and we ain't kidding. And she was, and after about 2 years in business, she did go under because of the seasonal nature out here. And there's a view of Sunset Inn when she was actually managing it. But what's interesting is this sidewalk. Today, Sunset Inn still sits right here. They don't have the shrubs. But the sidewalk, it just looks like it ends. You can see a head wall here. You can see the water lines. They used to have wooden planks over that. That was a bridge that went across Dixon Bay. That's why that sidewalk goes out. So if you stand at that end of that sidewalk today, you'll see the head wall where they cut those water lines off. And there's just another picture in the snow. When World War II broke out, the CCC went away. The Dallas Park Board negotiated with the Department of Defense saying, you can use this property for anything you deem necessary. First thing they deemed necessary was a rehabilitation facility for soldiers with sexually transmitted diseases. Well, you can guess how well that went over with the neighbors. It didn't. So they went back and renegotiated their contract, and it became a ferrying unit. Then it became a branch of the Mahaya POW camp. It housed officers from Rommel's famed Afrika Corps. They worked deep nights at a factory at Fair Park, mending uniforms and mess kits. And this was during that time, somebody shared this with me, it's 1945, a seaplane, Navy seaplane, set down at White Rock Lake on its way to Eagle Mountain Lake, and it ran low on fuel. And so according to the newspaper, they refueled, stayed, spent the night at the POW camp, then they took off the next day. Well, Johnny Williams Jr., whose dad had the Bonnie Barge and everything out at the lake, he laughed. He said, no, they were lost. They thought they sat down at Eagle Mountain Lake. They were surprised to find out it wasn't. So I don't know which is true, his story or the newspaper. Oh, and I love this picture. This is the Bonnie Barge. And I was doing a tour, and these two older ladies were on the back of the bus. They're in their 80s, and they call me to the back. And I go back, and they show me this picture. I already have it, but they show me this picture. They're twins, and they were juniors at Garland High School when they got the call to go out and pose for this picture. And one of them said, we only had one bathing suit between the two of us. And the other one said, yeah, and I had the better looking legs, so I got to wear the bathing suit. My sister had to wear her dress and is standing on the top. So I don't know which one of those lovely beauties in the bottom is the twin sister. I just love the story. This is 1947 aerial. Now we know where the CCC camp was, but you see that this is Garland Road. You see the spillway. You see the fish hatchery here. This today is the Dallas Arboretum. You see a few more trees than we did earlier in the 1920s, and a little more development. You see homes coming here. This is Winfrey. Those are the last few buildings there at the CCC camp. After the war, it became overflow housing for SMU. I've seen maps that called that area Perunaville. I was like, I had no idea SMU's mascot is called Peruna. And so that's why that area on the map said Perunaville. That was their overflow housing for young men. And there's another view showing those last two. And by September of that year, all of them were gone. And we have a very detailed listing on what and where every single one of those buildings went. That is Winfrey Point, the building there. This is the Hunleys. They operated at the lake from 1947 up until about 1993. After Mr. Hunley passed away. That is his wife. She ran the concession stand, also sold baits. And the daughter told me that in the summer when it got really hot, she'd load up all the minnows in an ice chest and take them home so that they wouldn't be hot. And the next few decades brought floods and droughts. Yep, and droughts. And not just physical floods and droughts, but floods and droughts of support. In 1994, Dallas Morning News ran a story about the death of an urban lake if something were not done. That's when the last dredging project that ended in 1999 was done. The lake filled in 1914. The first time they talked about needing to dredge was 1920. So that's always been a problem at White Rock with the silt that comes in. And at the same time, the Park Department started updating their trails. We also did some black land restoration. When they started this, there were just 131 plant species. Today, there are over 500 plant species. When you bring the native plant life back, what happens? You get the native wildlife back. And the pelicans aren't native to Texas, but we have over 100 white pelicans that winter at White Rock Lake. They've just come in, so if you want to go down between now and March to see the pelicans, they're a lot of fun to watch. Red-tailed hawks, there's the buntings, and yes, we have lots of bobcats and lots of coyotes. And I would get the calls that would come into City Hall that nobody else knew what to do with, and I had this lady who was hysterical. She was calling me. She was walking her dogs up on the dam, and the little one had run down into the old fish hatchery. She heard it yelping, so the big dog ran down after it. The next thing she knew, there were a coyote chasing her dogs as they were running towards her, and she wanted to know what I was going to do. I said, well, your first mistake, your dogs were not on a leash. Oh, but they love to chase the rabbits. Said the rabbit is a coyote's dinner. If it can't have the rabbit, it is just as happy to have one of your dogs. She didn't call me back, but yeah, there's a reason for the leash laws. And even up in here, you've got wildlife. The reason for the leash laws in the parks isn't just to protect you from your neighbor's dog, but also to keep them separate from the wildlife. We also restored the facilities. I showed Dreyfus, even though it burned to the ground. We did restore it before it burned to the ground. We also have been replacing all the playgrounds. This one's kind of fun. This one on the left is TNP Hill, and the little train caboose is Southern Pacific. We also have the first statue honoring the Boys in Green, the CCC, in the state of Texas. It was the 21st one in the country. It's called Iron Mike. Those are actually some alumni there that came for the dedication, and I won't tell you how many 90 plus year old men appointed to him go, you know, I modeled for him. He's a buff young man. When we were redoing the trail there on the west side along by TP Hill, there's a park called Lakewood, and it was separated by a high train trestle. It was an elevated train track. They went and they were looking at this old master plan, found where the Katy Spur went under the Sopac Trail, Sopac line. And all we had to do to reconnect it is take the dirt out. The concrete stanchions were still there holding what would have held that old bridge up. And that bridge right there of the trail is made to look like a train trestle because that's what it originally was. Had a donor who provided this Morris Levy overlook on the west side. That's just a pretty view of it. This is an overlook. This is made to look like something the CCC would have built. Potter Metal Art actually did those lights. We also restored Big Thicket. It was a joint project with For Love of the Lake and Home Depot. Home Depot won a national award for this. I also had the great honor of hosting a national CCC reunion. And these are some of the boys. They still call each other boys. But one of them was really interesting, this guy in the white hat. I got calls from all over the country, but this guy called me. And he was telling me how he was from Dallas. He signed up in 39. They sent him to New Mexico. He came back. He got a little education, joined the Navy. He was sent to Pearl Harbor. He was a Pearl Harbor survivor. But he did get injured in the South Pacific. He married, I told him the whole story, married a nurse, came back to Dallas, became a police officer. His picture's actually out in one of those bookcases out there. He was a man handcuffed to Oswald when he was shot. That's James Lavelle in the white Stetson. You see him in that famous picture wearing his white Stetson. So the history of our country came through these men. Just fascinating. When we redid this pavilion, we also found that this piece on the end had been removed. We rebuilt it. This was new. White Rock Lake used to come up to Flagpole Hill. Now it's south of Mockingbird. So we created this new entrance, which looks like a CCC-built entrance into a state park. Very pretty there at Flagpole Hill. I told you we had wonderful carpenters. We also have wonderful painters. They stripped off 70 years of paint and took this building back to the original pine siding. Looks completely different, doesn't it? Beautiful building. And I had a conversation with some gentlemen. One of the other things we did is Dallas has these 911 signs on their trails. So if you were to have an accident or get injured, all you have to do, if you go down, you call 911 and you give them that number, and those first responders know exactly how to get to you. There was also, we talked about spillway damage. It's really interesting. Remember, Water Department's responsible for the dam and the spillway. This was a $16 million project. Park Department put $1 million in. The rest of it was done by the Water Department, but the Park Department gets a whole lot of use out of this. Very nice. The way they redid the trail with overlooks. New dog park, they have updated with a new launch. We've been restoring with a White Rock Lake Conservancy, been restoring stone tables. My first book, White Rock Lake, Speedboat Race. Second one, White Rock Lake Revisited. The books are $22, and I'll be here to sign if you're interested. And that's it, over 100 years at White Rock Lake. I have to talk fast to get a sentence over 100 years in.
We'll take questions and we'll take your stories.
I have two. One, the first question is, how does Daniel Sullivan fit into the early parts of White Rock?
Daniel Sullivan?
He did a plan. Okay.
He did a plan.
Because he was the water commissioner, and I know he had a lot to do with it, but I don't know what.
No, and a lot of the information I took, employees of the Water Department wrote a history book of the Water Department, and so I took their White Rock information.
Okay. And my other question is, from whom did we purchase the land?
There's a map that shows who we bought all of the properties from. We bought them in multiple, some of them small, some of them very large.
Cool.
But there's probably, I don't know, 75 landowners.
Oh, okay.
There were a lot of landowners. But John does have that map that I found. I found it in the vault at Public Works, just stumbled upon it. It's a wonderful map.
I was curious to know more about the Bathhouse Cultural Center. It's one of my favorite places to go now because of the art gallery and the theater. But I swear, I'm not from here originally, but I swear in the early 80s we went there to see a movie, the Ayn Rand's movie Anthem, and it was just shown on a little projector on a screen, and there was nothing in there.
That is operated by Cultural Affairs, which is a completely different department. And then there's another department that maintains the building. So the Park Department now has little to nothing to do with the Bathhouse Cultural Center.
But do you know when they actually started using it again?
I want to say, because I was in there about 86, so it had to have been in the early 80s. that they started using it.
Okay. But was there a time period when it just was
closed? It sat vacant for probably over 30 years.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And the upstairs, those were the locker rooms. There's a downstairs. It's mostly just kind of open. Mm-hmm. And there's a place where you rinse your feet. There's this little square thing where you rinse your feet before you came up and got out of your suit.
All right. Well, thank you.
There was also a concession building under there.
Any idea how many POWs were there during the war, and were they allowed to use the facilities?
Actually, they did a lot of work around the lake. A lot of the landowners around the lake would come and hire them out. And nobody ever escaped. And so, the commander said, if you were living here, would you try to escape? And I don't care what time of the year, even when it's over 100 degrees, you go up to Winfrey Point, there is always a breeze. I mean, it is really windy up there. And so there's a lot of air movement, so it makes it really comfortable up there. But I know there were 200 in the CCC, so that's about what it would hold.
You were talking about how it'd be comfortable there at the lake, even on the hottest of nights. I grew up in Dallas, and I guess, well, we used to go to the lake all the time because that was back before we even had air conditioning. Of course, we had double-hung windows, but that was to let the heat out the top and the cool air in the bottom. To me, it never made that much difference. But anyway, we used to get in the car. We had all the windows down. And there was a road that we would go down that cut on the way down to White Rock Lake. And that road was just, it was real kind of a spooky road. And the trees were up there. Of course, we had lightning bugs back then. And it was just like going to fairyland in a way. But that was our air conditioning. And that's what I remember. And then Daddy would take us down under the little underpass, past the boathouse. And then we would do a tour of the lake at night. It was really quite beautiful.
Well, I will admit, I used to go to the submarine races when I was in high school. And my editor in book number two, I mentioned that, and the editor said, you have to explain what that is. I was like, okay. So I did, and then another editor did the final. He goes, why is this in here? And I said, well, the other editor told me I had to. He said, now take that out. If they don't know what going to the submarine races is, they don't need to know. I said, okay. Anybody know what going to the submarine races would be? Raise your hand. All right. Michael, you don't know? Okay. Okay.
I came over this evening because I am currently working with some of the descendants of the folks that own the land that is now the Arboretum.
Oh, okay.
Alex Camp and Roberta Koch Camp, they had 22 acres on the northern end, and the DeGoyers had 44 on the southern end. They actually were real estate developers. They developed Fair Park back in the early 1900s, and then they bought no telling how many hundreds of acres around the south and east side of the lake, which they developed, and then it wound up being deeded to the city of Dallas to form the Arboretum back in the 70s, I suppose.
But yeah.
We're doing a book on that currently. It's fascinating to get the history.
Well, and there's a lady who lives in Forest Hills, and I can't tell you her name. She gave me some pictures that are in my second book, so I've got her name there. But her great-great-grandparents were sharecroppers, and they worked that property. And they lived in the log cabin, you know, the one that's downtown. They lived in the log cabin on that property, and she has pictures of it, of that log cabin on the property.
Well, Alex Camp and his brother bought all of that property around the southeast of the lake and, you know, started selling it off as real estate developers. And they kept 22 acres that they had bought, I think, from the gentleman you just referenced.
No, because, was it Meadows? It's a big name, big property owner that we bought that property from. Carruth. We bought that property. We bought adjoining property from the Carruths.
Well, the family house that's in the Arboretum.
Uh-huh, the DeGallias.
Was the camp house.
Was that the camp house?
The DeGoyers are next door.
Oh, okay. I know the camp house. Yeah.
Questions, comments, protest.
Seems like I remember back in the 50s there was the paddle boats.
Yes, that's the Hundleys,
okay,
who had the bait shop. They also had the paddle boats.
Okay, I remember that.
Yeah. They started with canoes and went on to paddle boats.
When did they ban all the big boats off of the lake?
In the 50s. Early to mid-50s.
They went strictly to the sailboats then?
Correct.
Was there a regatta team from SMU that used to use the lake?
Now, they have longboats out there. They have a lot of longboats out there now. They do rowing.
Okay.
And not just sailing. They do rowing out there also.
Okay. Well, I remember standing on the spillway while, you know, when it would flood and Lothar Drive was flooded, we'd get in the car and we'd drive out to White Rock Lake and go drive through all the water, which you're not supposed to do.
Right.
And then we used to get out and we'd stand on the spillway and those rocks down in there.
Right.
And, you know, the water would be coming across. Why we didn't get swept away, I don't know. But that was just one of the things we did for enjoyment.
My second book has some pictures of some girls from Woodrow standing on the rocks.
I have a picture of my feet, or, you know, the water's rushing across my feet, and I'm standing there with the camera. How intelligent was that?
How many of you stood on the spillway when it was raining? And your daddy's told you not to. It is a miracle we didn't get washed away. You look like you have a story. Yeah. A White Rock story?
Well, I live pretty close. I'm one of the Woodrow girls. My dad used to deliver mail to the DeGoyers many years ago. And we all spent many times out at White Rock Lake. And we did do the submarine race. We did see the submarine races.
Can you tell us about?
Do what?
I don't know how many people familiar with the old Thornton German castle.
Instead of calling it going parking, you were going to watch the submarine races. Yep.
At the corner of West Shore and Gaston, down in a hole, is the old R.L. Thornton castle home.
Right.
I lived about a block or so from there. Walk or ride your bike out White Rock Road to the pump house and fish off the dam. Remember those days well. Wade in the spillway. So anyway.
And Mary Brenniger at the Dallas Arboretum, her grandfather was R.L. Thornton.
I have a story growing up in Richardson. I went to White Rock Lake to walk in the March of Dimes walk every year. And one year back in probably 1970, I did the walk, probably raised $1,000 for the March of Dimes. And I made the front page of, it was either the Dallas Morning News or the Dallas Times Herald, so.
I just wanted to ask you, how deep is the deepest point out in the lake?
I honestly don't know, not very deep. They did dredge and finish dredging in 1999, but I couldn't. Once again, that is maintained by the Dallas Water Department. They can tell you, but that's out of my realm.
Two quick questions, one long one. Have we interviewed any of the Rommel, inmates?
No.
Final question, unless anybody else has a question. Tell us a little bit about the Lady of the Lake. I remember growing up, KLF would say, she's been spotted, and we'd all run out there, and nobody found her. But can you
tell us? Did you know there's, I think, about 5 or 6 other locations in the country that have exactly the same Lady of the Lake story? And the story is a couple is driving around White Rock Lake. They see a young girl in a formal dress, and it's all wet, and they offer to take her home. When they get to her home and they go up to the door, they turn around, and there's just a puddle of water. And the young girl on the way to the prom had drowned in a car accident. And that's, but I filmed Kevin Zorbo, who was Hercules. Anybody remember Kevin Zorbo and Hercules? Well, last year, Lifetime was doing a series called The Haunting Of. And he actually, I mean, in talking to him, and I will tell you, he's much older and not as buff, but he's still a very nice-looking man. But anyway, he was a bouncer at a club in the early 80s in Dallas. And after he got off work, it was about 3 o'clock in the morning, he drove in East Lothar from Garland Road. And he was talking to his girlfriend. He kept seeing this image of this lady anyway. And he said he never went back to the lake because it really scared him. And so they had a medium there who was trying to figure out what the real story was. Anyway, it was kind of interesting.
How is she involved with Cox Cemetery?
Who?
You mentioned that the Cox Cemetery might be...
Oh, that is just it's an urban myth that's purportedly where she's buried. Where the Lady of the Lake is buried.
Y'all remember the radios saying, she's out there, and we all drive out there to try to find her. And there are all these big cars there. And they said, well, you just missed her. The radio announcer would say, you just missed her. She's gone. Questions? Any other last-minute questions? Sal Rodriguez, thank you.